recording. Hello, dear participants, students and friends, professors, let's welcome out today's lecture, Professor Paul Regan. Professor Paul Regan is an Associate Professor of Law and Associate Director of the Institute of Delaware Corporate and Business Law at Delaware Law School. Professor Regan, thank you for joining us tonight. Eileen Green, who is Assistant Dean and Executive Director at the Delaware Law School, is also with us today. And the lecture will be on the fiduciary duty of loyalty, the Delaware Corporate Opportunity Doctrine. Professor Regan, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you for that. And thank you for the nice introduction. And it's great to be here. And it's so pleasant to reconnect with some old acquaintances like with Marion Dent. And we've had some classes where students from Moscow have been in person, and I've taught this course called Advanced Corporation Law or Advanced Concepts in Corporation Law. And this topic today is really pulled right out of that class. And so I look forward to a day where I can teach students in person. And my guess is all of you are looking forward to a day where you don't have to worry about meeting online or on Zoom. But as I said, this is actually a fantastic platform through Zoom where on this, your evening here on Friday in my early afternoon, we can have this conversation conveniently for all of us and connect this way. And so to that extent, I think coming out of COVID, this is one of the things we've discovered that we can do conveniently with each other, even when we're together in person, but looking forward especially to doing all that. So very nice to be with you all. I congratulate you students on your studies, and it's great to talk to lawyers around the world here, and especially in Russia and Moscow, and as your studies at Pericles, and I hope that's going well for you. So I'm going to talk today about Delaware corporation law, which in the United States, just because of historical accident, is the most important corporation law or company law in the United States. We have this quirky kind of system, and anybody who's trying to study US law will figure out, like, wow, there are some strange things there. We have a law that regulates our stock market, the trading of stocks and bonds in our stock market for public investments in different companies. Federal law regulates that. It's a disclosure law regime that basically says we want transparency. So if you want to be Facebook and trade on the stock exchange or Twitter, you have to reveal your financial information so investors have the information. And federal law covers that. Facebook is a Delaware corporation, so is Twitter. But federal law governs the stock market. But we're talking about is Delaware state law, which governs everything inside the corporation and the fiduciary duties. This leads to a comment here, particularly because I'm talking to an audience who's more familiar with either your country and our legal differences, and I don't pretend to understand even a lot or even a little bit, but about, you know, when you have a civil code system, there's a code, there's a legal system, rules, and anybody in this field advising corporations or their directors or managers would obviously need to pay attention to what those rules are and help make sure the client follows them. And in Delaware, we have a code, it's a Delaware corporation law code, and any lawyer in this field would need to know the code and advise the clients about that. Today's topic is part of this other rich body of other law, which we call the common law. And if you maybe you've studied a course about how does US law work, you know, we were a colony from Great Britain, and so we inherited their tradition of, sure, we have some codes, but a lot of the law comes from judge-made cases after case, and so you have these precedents and the like. And the concept of fiduciary duties is one of the highest accountability of anybody in the world. And it comes from the principle of basically when directors of a corporation that is invested by other people, shareholders put all their money in that corporation, but the directors and the officers manage the corporation and the shareholders go home. They once a year get to vote to pick their directors. And now the board of directors of a Delaware corporation has control of many times billions and billions of dollars. In the case of Apple, it's $2 trillion of US wealth. It's a massive amount of money. And so when I teach this in my classes, I talk about what I love about corporation law. It's interesting to me, but also is the human relational element. our common law of fiduciary duties is really to respond to what we know about people, just lived experience, and what we call in the US, in English, human nature. Maybe there's some phrase you have in Russian to catch it, but people might not do the right thing when money's involved and no one's looking, right? They have access to someone else's money, but they might be tempted to steal some of it or be more clever. They're not gonna steal it, but the agent transactions that get them to take some of the money and they pretend to provide services. So on the surface, it looks normal enough, but it is a form of just taking other people's wealth. And today's topic, the fiduciary duty of loyalty, is a common law, Delaware common law principle. It's in other states as well, as a protection against that and also an accountability mechanism. It comes to us in a case which I think is so interesting, and I hope you'll enjoy it. And I'm going to pull the slides up now. It involves a doctrine called corporate opportunity. And this, let me just get the slides up for us to share here. Hopefully you can see them without me expanding the slides in their entirety. Let's see if I can scroll down a little bit. There you go. Okay, so this is our topic. It's the fiduciary duty of loyalty is broad. And in this instance, we're talking about one part of it called the corporate opportunity doctrine. And so let's talk about it as we get underway. Sorry, I'm gonna try to, I'm gonna stop sharing the screen and I'm gonna have my slides fully expanded so that you can see the language better there. Okay, so right now, of course, I'm not sharing them. So I had to figure out how to do that, forgive me. Let's go back to my Zoom call and share screen, all right. All right, so we're back again. I'm having trouble reaching. There it is. That's the button I'm trying to get to. Thank you. All right, so now we're on our way. And thank you for your patience. So this doctrine of the fiduciary duty of loyalty is this human nature principle. Now, I don't know. I know that when I've talked to students on campus from Russia in the past, they were aware of some, and maybe you've watched some American films, you know, different ones that you enjoyed or not. And one of them is, there's a series of movies about the superhero Spider-Man. You might remember the Spider-Man movie. I don't know if it's familiar to you or not, but I call this the Spider-Man principle. Sorry, this first page, with great power, and Spider-Man has great power, comes great responsibility. That's the line from the movie. Maybe you remember that. But for us, I call it the OPM principle. OPM is my acronym for other people's money. If you have control over other people's money, the Delaware courts are going to hold you accountable. You have great power, but you can't just use it for selfish reasons. You have to use it for making their wealth better and honorable reasons. So we have some cases here and some language. A director is vested with this power, this management of the affairs. They must execute that duty, recognizing it's not about them, they're acting for others. And so they have this unyielding fiduciary duty to the corporation and its shareholders. So my first day I meet to the students, I put this little formula in here. Einstein's brilliant E equals MC squared, the understanding of the theory of relativity and so forth. In this case, other people's money equals fiduciary duties. That to me is like the equation of all of business organizations law. It gets to relationships and holding people accountable in those relationships. So here's some language from the case we're gonna talk about, this case called Guth versus Law. Just some samples of how the court expresses that. If you're a fiduciary, and you are, if you're a court officer or a director, you're not allowed to use this position. You're in a position of trust. You have other people's money and you can't use it for private selfish gain. It's not about me, it's about the shareholders, right? And so the case law talks about this. We've lived life, we've seen it. A profound knowledge of human characteristic and motives. We're aware of how people might succumb or fall to temptation. And so a fiduciary duty checks against that, right? They have to refrain from causing harm or keeping it from profit that it should be getting. And so this undivided, unselfish duty of loyalty imposes on directors and officers that there can be no conflict between my duty to the shareholders and my self-interest, right? And so the law extinguishes all possibility of personal profit from the breach. So this case is old, but it is still referred to in Delaware. It is cited again and again because it's a strong statement of how vigilant, how careful the Delaware courts are to hold fiduciaries accountable for their loyalty. It comes to us in a case involving a corporation called Loft Incorporated. So a loft could be like an apartment in New York. It's an apartment up there in an old warehouse, or it could be the top building of a house or something. Hey, up in the loft is where we store stuff. And that was the kind of nice name they gave to their business. And in the 1930s, the 1920s in the US, none of us in the US had traveled very much. And we hadn't figured out that you can actually get really good coffee in other parts of the world. And so it took until like my lifetime to say, wow, no wonder people in Russia love their coffee so much, or in Europe, or elsewhere. And so back then it was soda, right? People liked the taste of soda. There was sugar and caffeine. That's like the dream fix to get your day started, or the middle of your afternoon. And so Loft was a company that had stores all over the East Coast of the United States. And again, if you've never been to the US, you surely, you know, you've seen New York on the East Coast and Washington, DC, a few hours south by car or by train. We call this the Mid-Atlantic states because the Atlantic Ocean is right there. And so those Mid-Atlantic states, incredibly concentrated population centers, obviously New York, all the way down from Boston to Washington. And Loft is headquartered in New York City. And what does Loft do? It does two things. It manufactures candy, and it's sort of a fun business, right? It's like the happy place to go is Loft. It makes candy and syrup. Syrup is the sugary flavoring they would mix the sodas with, and different kinds of beverages. But what they really mostly did was they had these retail stores. And in the United States in the 1920s and the 1930s, these stores, and I'll have some pictures in a sec, were the equivalent of what would be today's cafe. A Starbucks or some other kind of coffee shop, where the US kind of said, why are we not doing what the rest of the world does? Let's have coffee shops where you can get, you know, a donut or a muffin or a scone and a coffee and something fancy and catch up with a friend you haven't seen in a long time. It's a very social and lovely thing to do. Well, back then it was candy and soda, sugar and caffeine. And the most popular soda in the United States was Coca-Cola. Obviously, you've seen the brand Coca-Cola. It's a global brand. It was dominant. It was like the Google of search engines when it came to soda. Nobody could compete with Coca-Cola. And so Loft bought all of its syrup to make the cola from Coca-Cola from Loft bought it all from Coca-Cola. Now, here's just some pictures that I enjoy because I've been to New York many times. I just love going there. And maybe some of you have visited to the States. And of course, a trip to is always what our students want to do, and why not? It's just a fascinating city. But these are pictures from this era. New York in the 30s, you know, motor cars are now filling up the streets alongside the trolleys. Skyscrapers are starting to emerge. The Empire State Building was finished in 1931, by the way, on St. Patrick's Day, just this very week. This change of this craziness of this giant skyscraper, New York, busy metropolis, people with some money to spend, and that's the scene. This is a streetcar scene. You see the subway, the metro stop down there. Again, this is Harlem in the 1930s. Again, that's another story. But in the early 1900s in the United States, Harlem is part of Manhattan. It's way up on the upper west side near Columbia University. And there was a renaissance of the Black American experience there. And the Cotton Club was just thriving. And that's a whole other story about American race relations and the like, but there was a thriving, booming cultural revolution going on in the Black community up in Harlem. And this, of course, is the book, Brooklyn Bridge. I got to walk over that with my wife, Patty, finally, after all these years of waiting. Lots of fun to do. That's the Lower East Side of Manhattan. But here's what these coffee shops kind of look like. So these people would gather and they would ask the bartender to mix up their favorite cola brand. And you know what, give me some of those chocolate candies or whatever. And just some other, this one's Harlem Thumbfords is a famous soda and candy store from Harlem back in that area. You see, this was what people wanted, soda and candy, sit down, meet with friends. This place, this looks like a crowded place, but here's an example. You would walk in, go to a booth, they bring you your freshly fixed made up soda, and you would meet with friends and have the time of your life. So key facts in the case. It's 1931 in this boom time of soda and candy shops. The company's called Loft, and Guff is the president in charge. He's on the board of directors. He's also the president of the company, and he's trying to make it a profitable company for the shareholders. So far, he's being a good fiduciary. And as only life can happen, he writes a memo. Today, it would be an email or a text message to his vice president. He's frustrated because Coca-Cola is charging a really high price for their syrup. And he discovers that Coca-Cola is charging them more in New York than in other cities, even though they're buying 10 times as much syrup in volume. And Coca-Cola's like, hey, it's New York, take it or leave it. So he asks his vice president to go find a cheaper source of cola syrup. This is one of these incredible facts that just shows up in the exact same week, out of nowhere. Mr. Guff gets a phone call and he meets with another individual named Mr. McGargle. And what's going on? There was a company called Pepsi Cola. Surely you've heard of that brand too. Pepsi has survived as a major cola brand around the planet, but it wasn't succeeding then. In fact, Pepsi was in bankruptcy. It tried to compete with Coca-Cola and it got crushed, right? And so Pepsi is in a federal bankruptcy case and is just breaking the company up. But McGargle was connected to Pepsi and he approached Guff and he says, Pepsi Cola is going out of business and we can buy its formula, the Pepsi secret formula for its cola and the Pepsi brand, the trademark, for a crazy small sum of $10,000. Even in 1931, this was a tiny, tiny little number. And this is the moment where Guff makes a choice. He could have gone to his board of directors and said, I think our problems are solved. We can make our own syrup the way we make other syrup. We can make cola syrup with this Pepsi brand and we can get it really cheap and we'll just build it up that way. But he didn't do that. He and Guff and Mr. McGargle took it for himself. So he's wearing two hats right now. And he and Guff decide, hey, we'll create a new version of Pepsi. And then when you're over at your other company wearing your hat, and you're wearing your hat as president of Loft, you'll cancel the Coca-Cola contract and just buy all of your syrup from our new Pepsi company. Certainly a financial conflict right there. So what I want to do right now is just, I like to do this when I'm sort of trying to explain how this works. So you have the Loft company, right? And Loft has 115 of these soda and candy stores at the retail level. As I mentioned though, that's the number 115. Sorry, it's hard to write this in handwriting. They also manufactured some of their own candy and some of their syrup, but they did not have a cola flavor syrup that they could make. And everybody in America seemed to be wanting to drink Coca-Cola. As I mentioned, Loft is, these lines represent the investors. These are the shareholders of Loft, and they elect the board of directors under Delaware corporate law to manage Loft. And the board appoints its officers, including the most senior officer, the president, and the defendant in the case, this gentleman by the name of Mr. Guff. So Guff wears many hats. I like to call them hats, right? He is a director on the board. He's an officer, right? So he is a fiduciary to all of these shareholders. And their world so far has been Coca-Cola when it comes to buying all that syrup. But he's tired of paying an excessive amount of money to Coca-Cola, I should put C Coca-Cola, under this contract. Along comes this opportunity to form the new version of Pepsi from the ashes, right? Pepsi-Cola in bankruptcy, going out of business. And so Guff, wearing his other hat, buys the Pepsi brand with this guy named Mr. McGargle. Now I'm leaving out a lot of history. McGargle dies in the next couple of years. And meanwhile, Guff has bought him out and owns over 90% of Pepsi. So all this happens in the same week as Only Life Can Happen. He's grumbling about, why are we paying so much to Coca-Cola? And all along comes this opportunity. And what Guth does not do is tell his own board of directors that hired him. And instead, he wears another hat. And this is the hat of me, right? For my own selfish profit. I always ask my students, why do you think Guth did this? They said, because he wanted him for himself. That's the correct answer, right? So what's amazing, picture a world of Coca-Cola dominant in every soda shop in New York, Washington, D.C., up toward Boston, Philadelphia. And you are Pepsi, the new Pepsi, and you come out and you go one store at a time. Hey, we're from Pepsi. Would you like to try our cola formula? It's cheaper than Coke. Get out of here. My customers only know Coca-Cola. I'm not going to buy your stupid Pepsi. But because our pal, Mr. Guth, is the controlling shareholder of Pepsi, and he's also the president over here, he decides that he's going to cancel the Pepsi, the Coca-Cola contract, and they make a new contract right here. And in one decision, every cola syrup part of their business for every store overnight is now Pepsi. So he's acting in a financial conflict. By the way, as you would expect in this instance, they lost money for the first year, right? They lost like several hundred thousand dollars because people went into the law offices, what is this? Oh, we're serving Pepsi now. Pepsi, oh, this is terrible. I'm going to the other soda store and getting my Pepsi, sorry, I'm getting my Coca-Cola fixed. I don't know about you there in Moscow. I like to make my own espresso at home. But when I'm buying my coffee away from home, I'm very specific about where I want to go. Turns out I'm not a fan of Starbucks. It's okay. I'll drink Starbucks. But there's another place around Delaware we call Brouhaha, which is where I get my caffeine fix. And you might have your favorite little cafe when you're meeting with friends from school or just somebody you're friendly with. And if they change your coffee blend, it's like, what is this? This isn't what it used to be. You're not coming back, right? And so that meant these 115 stores are going to take a financial hit. And Mr. Guth does this knowing that would happen to advantage himself at the expense of the company. Not only that, to get people to come back, they're spending money for things they never spent money for. Advertising. Hey, check out the new Pepsi Cola. It's better than Coke and it's cheaper. You should try it and so forth. So that was kind of the maneuver that went on there. So let's get back to the slides. So Guth grabs the chance for himself. Even worse, to grow Pepsi from nothing, you need money. No problem. Guth puts on his hat from the Loft company. He used Loft's money to build up the Pepsi empire that's now selling cola to the company. As I mentioned, Loft incurred some early losses. They had to spend money in advertising. None of it was proof, all done without board approval, knowledge, or approval. So the court in Guth versus Loft gets a lawsuit. Well, who sued? The corporation itself found out what he'd been up to for years, and Loft sued Guth. The case is called Guth versus Loft because Guth lost in the trial court, and now he's appealing. So he's the first name in the case. It's called Guth versus Loft. But the corporation filed the lawsuit. And the court announces this common law idea called a corporate opportunity doctrine. And they have four pieces that you have to evaluate. Now, in Delaware, the duty of loyalty is very broad, but this is one part of it. So the idea is, if I'm a fiduciary of Loft, I should be allowed to invest in other things like real estate, a music company. But if something comes to me in my executive business capacity, that's a really promising business opportunity. That's number one. It comes to me not personally, but as an executive of Loft, and the company has the money to pursue it, and it's related. This new opportunity is related to what we already do. It's within our line of business. And then this is an equity idea. Our Delaware courts are courts of equity. And it says, and the corporation has an interest in that. If all of these things are true, then you cannot keep it for yourself. you have to share it with your corporation. And if you don't, you're liable for a remedy. So the court now is going to, what we do, apply this stuff. We're talking about the application of these parts of the rules. The battleground is going to be one and two. The company had plenty of money and they were looking for a new cola supplier. So the real fight is going to be in the first and the third category. Let's look at them. The court decides, yes, Guth, they came to you, McGargle came to you as an executive. There's no other explanation. Of all the people in the world, why would McGargle choose you? Why? Because Coca-Cola was the dominant brand. How could you fight Coca-Cola and start up a new Pepsi on your own? And it was impossible to induce other establishments to use Coke, to use a cola drink that wasn't Coca-Cola, one store at a time. But if McGargle could get Guth on board, Guth was in charge of every one of the 115 stores. And in one decision, he does exactly that. And so it's pretty clear by the time of the lawsuit, McGargle has died, but the inferences, the evidence is very strong that this came to Guth wearing his manager hat of Loft. And so check one against Mr. Guth. The second one's easy. Did Loft have the money? Yeah. In fact, Guth used Loft's money to finance the whole thing. So that was kind of a laugh or easy on that one, right? The third one was tricky. This was the whole battleground of the lawsuit. What was the line of business of Loft compared to Pepsi? Was it related? Well, Pepsi didn't have any retail stores. It didn't have any candy shops or soda fountain shops. It was a wholesale manufacturer of syrup in plants around the country, and they shipped the syrup to these retail stores. So Pepsi's wholesale and Loft's identity was a retail operation. So that was the big battleground there in the case. But the court finds it was within the line of business. And for purposes of this doctrine, the court decides that the line of business test for relatedness is how Delaware will approach this. And so the court says, look, it's true. Loft was mostly retail, but you had some own manufacturing wholesale. They manufactured other syrups, not just a cola syrup. And the court says this line of business test for fiduciary accountability has to have a flexible meaning. And what we're going to ask is the business you're in and that you are a fiduciary in, does it have the kind of knowledge already in place and the experience to expand into this? Is it crazy different? Then it's not related. But if it's close to what you do, and already you have knowledge and practical experience to expand, then it's within your line of business and you cannot take it for yourself. As part of this analysis, what's interesting is Mr. Guth, who was a fiduciary and the highest executive at Loft, he himself is part of the problem against himself because the company's ability includes him. He owes his abilities to Loft, and he knows how to run a wholesale as well as a retail operation. So the court rules against him on this crucial battleground. And the other one was, is there any expectation, not contract law, but just fairness ideas? Did you fairly expect to be able to have this opportunity? And the evidence was crazy coincidence. Literally in the same week that this Pepsi case arose, Guth had written this memo to his vice president about, we got to get rid of Coca-Cola. We need another way to find syrup. And even said his memo, what about that PepsiCo company that I heard about? Look at that. So this memo really dooms him here. And so finding cola was an urgent necessity, and Loft had this practical concern to get that trademark and formula. So the court says all four elements are met. Mr. Guth has breached his fiduciary duty of loyalty and will be liable. This would be fun. I've never told anybody that I'm a genius. I usually say the opposite, like things come slow to me, but I just work harder than most people. But in any case, at the trial, Guth tried to tell the court that I'm a genius and that I deserve the profits from being a genius. What do you mean? Well, Pepsi Cola exploded in value. It was highly successful, of course, thanks to putting it in every one of the 115 stores. But what really got Pepsi going was Guth had this idea. These Americans are in a hurry all of a sudden, right? Like, I don't know about you, But sometimes I'm not in a mood to sit down and have a coffee with somebody for a long period of time. I actually love doing that. It's one of my favorite things to do, slow life down, meet in a cafe and catch up with somebody I love and a friend and catch up on old times, right? But sometimes I'm in a hurry, I'm in the car and I want a coffee to go, right? And in this case, he came up with soda to go. It had always been mixed in a machine and you were handed an actual glass. But he came up with 12-ounce bottles of soda that was already mixed. And he says, so I should get credit for that. The problem is he was a fiduciary for Loft, and that genius of his idea didn't belong to him. It belonged to Loft. And so the court says, you know, a genius in his line he may be. But the law makes no distinction between the wrongdoing genius and the one less endowed. Your genius, your invention, and there's a little cartoon picture of it. This is the 12-ounce Pepsi pre-mixed bottle of 12 ounces of sparkling Pepsi-Cola refreshing that changed the soda world. Now, Coca-Cola's no chump, so they copied them right away and came up with their own version of the 5-cent ready-to-go. If you're in a hurry, I'll give you the bottle over the counter, open it up, and off you go. If you want to sit down, we'll mix you one up very nice and ready to roll. So what about the remedy? In other words, the court rules that Guth has breached his duty of loyalty to the corporation of Loft and all of Loft's shareholders by selfishly taking this Pepsi opportunity for himself under this corporate opportunity doctrine. So in our courts of equity, in the Delaware courts of chancery, there's all kinds of creative remedies. And one of them is like trust law. You might own those shares of Pepsi, but the court declares your ownership is charged with a legal trust in equity, I should say. And so they actually don't belong to you. He's up to 91% now. They belong in equity to law. And the court orders that he just transfer all that stock over to the company that he was a fiduciary for, to Loft. By the way, the Pepsi Cola that you know today around the planet came out of that transfer. All that stock that he built it into this multi-million dollar empire from, just think about that, $10,000 into many, many millions. And today, Pepsi has a market capitalization of $190 billion. Now, just in the U.S., $1 billion is $1,000 million. I would love to win the lottery for $1 million. Imagine winning that 1,000 times. That's $1 billion. It's worth 190 times $1 billion. And Guth's family blew it because Guth blew it for the rest of his family because he didn't behave as a good fiduciary. The other remedy is known as an accounting. You've probably heard the word accounting. That's like the financial report of the company's finances. But in this instance, in equity, it's a remedy where you have to get financial numbers, you hand them over to the court, but then you write a check for all the money you got out of Pepsi, like if he got any dividends or profits on those Pepsi shares, because they didn't really belong to him from the very beginning. He should have brought that opportunity to the board of directors. And everything that came from that did not belong to him. Even any salary he got from Pepsi, he would have to give it over. Here's a good question I'd like to ask. What if Guth gets this Pepsi opportunity? And he's like, this is a game changer. We're gonna cancel the Coke contract. We're gonna put Pepsi in every store. We're gonna lose money, I predict, for at least a year. We're gonna have to spend advertising, but I believe we can make this work, right? I would really, really like to do this for myself and not share it, but I want to be a good fiduciary and I probably should go to my board of directors first. So what if, which did not happen, Guth had gone to the board and said, this opportunity's come up. I'm wondering if the board would give me permission to pursue it on my own. And then I will sell the syrup to the corporation at a fair price, lower than Coca-Cola. And if the board thinks that's okay, the board might say no. But if the board said yes, under Delaware case law, you have permission in advance to do it. It's called a safe harbor. A board can consent to a fiduciary pursuing an individual, even if it's, right, if the board is fully informed and the board itself has no conflicts. You will have a conflict, but if the board is aware of it, that's okay. And the case law says that would be a safe harbor kind of a thing. So to summarize, directors and officers of a Delaware corporation are fiduciaries under Delaware state corporate law. It's a common law, strong common law principle. And you can't use that position of trust for personal financial gain. And it comes up in any number of moments. You can't steal the money and you can't do transactions where you're getting something to the detriment of the company you're serving. Some other examples of being a loyalty violator would be like, we have something called insider trading. If my company gets really good news and I figure tomorrow we're gonna tell a press release to the world about, hey, we just discovered a lot of oil in Texas and our stock's gonna go up really fast. And they tell me because I'm the president and I need to know this for the press release tomorrow, and I go buy a lot of the stock, that's a violation of our federal stock market law. We call it securities laws, but it's also a violation of loyalty. You bought the stock today, think about this, from the company's current shareholders, and you owe them fiduciary duties. You had information, inside information, that they didn't have. And you bought their stock on the cheap, and tomorrow the stock goes up, and in effect, you're taking money from those shareholders. That information that you got as an insider isn't for you. It's for corporate business knowledge purposes. You took it for yourself. That's an example as well of a loyalty violation. Another one are self-dealing transactions. By the way, that happened here too, because Guff is president of Loft, but he's also the controlling shareholder of Pepsi. So he has a self-dealing transaction. He says to himself, well, Mr. Guff, would you like to buy all your syrup for your stores from Pepsi? Yes, I would. And he says, well, how much would you like to charge me? As much as we possibly can. I think that's a great deal, kind of a deal, right? And of course, in addition, of course, the heart of the problem is the misappropriation of a corporate business opportunity. In equity, this related important opportunity to expand the Loft soda and candy store retail plus some wholesale stuff belonged to Loft, and you in effect stole that from them. You misappropriated that. And so the corporate opportunity doctrine is just one species, one type of broad fiduciary duties assumed by a corporate director and officer. So that's my prepared remarks, if you will, through those slides. I hope you find that interesting about how Delaware fiduciary duty of loyalty works. These are broad thematic ideas of you cannot act in your self-interest financially at the expense of the corporation that you are in charge of. You just cannot do that. And then after that, it's everything is the facts. Like what, there's a story. How did that become a loyalty issue? And every case takes that broad theme of no self-interest before the shareholder's interest. And did you do that? And we'll see the remedies are very creative and very significant and the like. So I'll invite anybody who has questions. Maybe some of the Pericles students would like to ask a question or comment, or any of my colleagues here on the faculty. I'd love to hear from you. Yes, please, Alexander.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Regan. It was really interesting. And I have a question. For example, if Mr. Guff goes to the board and asks for approval if he can buy the shares of Pepsi shares, and they then the board says no, could he ask them if, for example, he can buy it for his own money? It means that, so if he got the denial from the Loft, then can he ask for approval to buy it on his own? For example, if a Loft company agrees to these conditions, no?
Yeah, I'm trying to understand the conditions. I think if the first reply is, hey, I'd like to pursue this on my own, and they say no, right? We want it. And I think your next part of the question was, if they say no to him, can he still buy some of the stock? Is that what you're asking me?
Yeah, I mean, like what the situation when the Loft company is aware that Mr. Guff wants to buy this Pepsi stocks on his own, but it was after the Loft's denial to buy Pepsi stocks.
Gotcha. Yeah, I think I don't think that's going to work. I think there's an expression, I don't know how it would translate into Russian, but there are times in life, my father said to me, you know, Paul, better to ask for forgiveness than for permission. I don't know if you explain it in language. If I ask for permission and they say no, and I do it anyway, I'm really in trouble because I am on notice in advance that this is not approved. If I don't ask for permission and they don't know about it, at least I can try to make an argument like, oh, was that wrong? I didn't realize that was wrong. Forgive me. I'm sorry. I just thought this would be okay, right? So I think it would be a strong case for the remedy of all of that. Yeah. Now, what would be interesting is, and I see there's another hand, I'd be ready to take that question too, is it'd be interesting is if he brought it to the board and said, hey, this thing's come up and I would like to pursue it, so I'm going to resign from Loft and pursue this on my own. That would be tricky because as I read the case, he cannot do that because it belongs in equity to Loft and he can't go resign and kind of, well, I'm getting rid of my fiduciary stuff. Because it came to him while he was a fiduciary kind of a thing, which would be interesting. I think Sergey maybe had a question up, or was there someone else?
Yes, Professor Pavel Zaitsev raised his hand.
Who was it? I'm sorry.
Virtually. Pavel
me. Good evening, Professor.
Oh, good evening.
Lecture.
Yeah, thanks, Pavel.
Thank you very much. So I have a question. As I understood, fiduciary duty is a principle, which is used in the, some kind of principle, which is used in the state of Delaware. Is there any similar principles or a case alike on the federal level?
Great question. There's a simple answer, which is no, but then I feel like that's incomplete. So let me say it this way, and it's a great question. So I thank you for that, Poe. Under Delaware law, let's just start there. There's this fiduciary duty of loyalty. I should tell you and your students there's actually two more in Delaware. There's one called the duty of care, and the other is the duty of good faith. The duty of care doesn't require directors to make good or wise decisions. That's not what the care duty is about. The duty is to make decisions with good information. Like before we decide anything, we should investigate the decision. So it's about the process. And good faith, so we have loyalty, care, and good faith is a duty to act consciously for what I believe, honestly believe, is the best interest of the shareholders. So back to your question. Our federal law is pretty much only concerned about information. So all these fiduciary arguments, which I think are the most interesting in all of corporate and securities law. I was fortunate enough to practice in this field in Delaware for almost 10 years. In all kinds of fiduciary litigation involving mergers and acquisitions. And it's just so interesting. Federal law doesn't ask the question about, was that loyal or fair or fully informed? Our federal law is disclosure. Now I'm oversimplifying, but Delaware is about fairness and fiduciary duties being fulfilled. And federal law just says, did the investors get the information? Did you give them all the important information? And if you did, great. And if you didn't, then you're in trouble. So, excuse me, like when a company goes public, like Facebook or something, then you have to give them all the finances and everything else. And by the way, the word for disclosure under our federal system is what's called material information. Material is just another way of saying the important stuff. Like, don't leave out the important stuff, but you can forget the little unimportant stuff. So it's kind of a standard. The reason I hesitate, Pavel, to your question is there's one little space, right, where I mentioned insider trading is a breach of the duty of loyalty, where it actually involves an overlap of our federal disclosure law and our state law. So under state law, if I'm Mr. Guth and I buy stock the day before there's great news going to go into the stock market and raise up the price, it's a breach of the duty of loyalty because I'm buying their stock with information they do not know. And as the fiduciary, I can't do that. I have to share that information with them when I'm buying their stock because that's what fiduciaries do. Now, if I'm buying a car from somebody that I've never met, they don't have to tell me everything. I can just ask them, how long have you owned it? And I ask questions and I buy the car and it breaks down, like, oh, I didn't do a good investigation. But if I buy a car from a fiduciary who's managing my property, they have to tell me everything they know. So the reason I mention that, Pavel, is in federal law, insider trading is a violation of the disclosure rules. But what's interesting is why? The federal courts say, well, when the directors and officers buy the stock in the stock market with information that they know the market doesn't know about yet, that's a fraud. Why is it fraud? Because they're fiduciaries of state law. They kind of use state law to say you had to disclose before you bought that stock, and therefore you violated federal law. So 98% no fiduciary conversation in our federal system, but within insider trading, it does kind of slip in there a little bit, if that helps. Yeah. And I think I saw another question. Sorry, I don't know how to pronounce your name.
Yuri Bristov is stays in the land.
Okay, go ahead. Fire away.
Yeah, I'm sorry for writing in Cyrillic. Thank you for the lecture, Professor Regan. And I have two questions. First is rather short. Would you be sharing your beautiful slides with us?
Oh, I would be happy to, sure. I emailed them to my colleagues, and certainly you can email them around. I'd be happy to do that. Would that be okay if we do that, Sharu?
Yes, we will share it with pleasure.
Thank you.
Of course.
Yeah.
All right, so that's an easy question.
Yeah, that was an easy one. And the second one would be beats harder. So as you said, basically the fiduciary duty combines a duty of care and duty of loyalty. So there has been a discussion about the waiver of either of these duties in Delaware law. And as far as I digged into this discussion, I didn't get a straight question. Can we waive either or both of these duties?
Yeah, this is a really great and important question. The short answer is no. Under Delaware corporation law, you cannot waive a fiduciary duty relationship in a corporation. Interestingly enough, Delaware has other kinds of business entities outside of corporation law. We have companies like a limited liability company, it's an LLC. And if you're looking under Delaware law, I'll just put the citation up here for you. Let me just clear that drawing. And if you look under our Delaware code, in the LLC statute, there's a really remarkable section called, it's strange that I have this memorized, but I was just sharing this with some other students yesterday. 18-1101C. 18-1101C says that you can eliminate or waive all fiduciary duties, right? So that's not true in corporate law. So far, Delaware has not allowed that, eh? But you can do it with LLCs and frankly with any other business organization in Delaware. There's lots of like a limited liability partnership, a general partnership, whatever. And it seems like the corporate law statute is kind of the Delaware brand, right? And the role of our Delaware courts, and that's been over 100 years now with this important development of case law, this rich body of fiduciary common law, is so important to kind of keeping the balance of two things. We want directors to be entrepreneurs and risk takers and innovators. And we don't want them to be afraid that if they get something wrong, they'll be liable for damages. So we want to protect that innovation. But we also want to make sure they know they're accountable as fiduciaries, because if they perceive that they
look like we lost professor's name.
They're unreviewed. I'm sorry.
Paul, you froze for a few seconds.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did my internet connection get on my back? Can you see me okay?
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that, my friends. It's usually been very stable. So what I say is, so Delaware in the corporate law space has not allowed that bargain. We're not gonna let you waive fiduciary duties at all. In an LLC, and I'm seeing this, and also a limited partnership, there are cases where they're publicly traded on Wall Street, and they have invested in a company that says, hey, heads up, there are no fiduciary duties here. All we are is contract. I promise this, and if I deliver, that's it. You get nothing more than me doing what I promised to do. And the Delaware courts say, look, that's what the legislature said. That's what our code says. So no fiduciary duties, that's what you signed up for. But your search is understandably frustrated because it doesn't exist in corporation law yet. The closest thing we have is actually a small example today. The duty of loyalty, the common law duty of loyalty, cannot be waived. But if Mr. Guth got permission, if they said, no, we don't want any part of a syrup manufacturer, if you want to go invest in that and sell us the syrup, we'll evaluate that at the time. That would be a little bit of a waiver, wouldn't it? Like, it belongs to Loft, but they said, no, thank you. We choose not to, and you can go ahead and do it. The other one is care. Care is not a duty to make good decisions. It's a duty to make informed decisions. This is a lot of money that isn't yours. So don't go spend it without doing any homework. Go do some due diligence before you make your choices, eh? But sometimes directors don't do enough due diligence. And are they vulnerable for money damages? There's another exception, and I'll give you the citation in our Delaware Code. I'll put it back up on the screen so you have it. So it's our Delaware Code. It's I forget the volume for the other, but it's 8 Delaware Code, section 102B7. And this is very limited. It's not a waiver of the duty of care, but you can agree that there's no money liability for a care violation if you put it in the certificate of incorporation. So it's kind of a contract, kind of a deal, right? So that's 8 Delaware Code 102B7. But what I think, the way I would maybe summarize all that is to say that I don't see the Delaware legislature allowing that for corporate law. Their answer is, hey, go do that in the other business entities. This is our brand. And fiduciary duties are a big part of keeping things in balance between encouraging good innovation and entrepreneurs, but holding them accountable as fiduciaries, as it will. Yeah. So great question. Thanks. And I think there's another one too as well, right? The next, how do I pronounce your name? I'm not reading the.
Evgeny, please go ahead.
Very pleased. Yeah.
Good evening, Arthur. Thanks for joining us for this interesting lecture. And my question is about this corporate opportunity test. As you mentioned, one of the criteria is opportunity presented to them in business capacity. So can you hear me?
I can hear you fine.
Let's go ahead.
Very good, yes.
Yeah, so let's imagine that I am this Mr. God, yeah? And I'm working from 9 till 6 and I didn't get any opportunities from my business activity as a president, yeah? And randomly at home, I've noticed some advert about Pepsi. Am I acting here, am I like a person for myself? Or should I use this hat like official of company and taking care about the interests of company and notice them about this opportunity that I have randomly seen? Because I'm not working right now. Yeah, I'm at home and it's my personal time and it's just my personal activity, reading newspapers or watching TVs, etc. So am I clear?
Oh, no, you're fine. It's a great question. Yeah, and I really appreciate the question. Thank you for that. I think a court in Delaware would probably say, yes, you're still a fiduciary even when you leave the building. You're a fiduciary when you're on the airplane, when you're on vacation playing golf. And someone says, hey, what do you do, Mr. Guth? I'm the president of Loft. We have a bunch of soda and candy stores in the mid-Atlantic states, and New York is our big market. And we're getting killed on this the cola syrup, you know? And they say, hey, we should talk after vacation because I've got this interesting thing. I think the court would say, yeah, no, you're still a fiduciary, off hours and whatever. But here's one that you might, and your colleagues might find interesting. There's a case in which fiduciaries of a technology company, and this is when digital technology was in the beginning. It's like the early 1980s, and digitization of our commercial life was just beginning. And this company could take documents for architects that do buildings, and they could scan them before the word scan existed, and put them up on computers, and then the architects could manipulate it in space like we do now, like on our phones. It's crazy, the revolution in technology. But this is the beginning, eh? So these two, there's three scientists and they're fiduciaries at this company. And they have a friend who's an inventor in another world. He's in his laboratory and he's fascinated by this digital technology. And he invents a better way to scan architectural documents. So it's a it's another step in the digital revolution, right? And it's way better. And he comes to these three workers and he says, you get science, you have a PhD in physics and you understand electromagnetic stuff. And he said, I have invented another way to do this scanning and I'm gonna form my own company, but will you do it with me, right? And so they said, yeah, sure, this is great. So they quit, they open the new company, and the first company they work for brings a lawsuit in the Delaware courts and says, corporate opportunity. They came to you as a fiduciary for us and you owe that invention and that opportunity. You should have brought it to us so that we can invest in the next generation of this instead of being behind. It's certainly related. Can we agree it's in the line of business? It's digital scanning of architectural renderings for computer manipulation. It's like clearly a line of business. Fascinating case though, because the Supreme Court of Delaware agreed and said no. And it gets to your first question. It says, did it come to him as a fiduciary or did it come to him in his individual, did it come to them in their individual capacity? And the answer to that was easy because the inventor that came to them said out loud, I'm going to start a company and I would love for you to join me, but I am not willing to offer it to your company. Get the idea? He said in advance, there is no way I'm going to let this invention go into that company because I see them as behind the technology curve and I want to get ahead of that curve, but I like your intellectual, your scientific and engineering gifts, join me. And so there is, so the court says, look, it's not a corporate opportunity if the one presenting the opportunity says the magic words, hey, do you want to do this with me? By the way, I would never offer it to your employer. You'd have to quit and then join me. And then that would be okay. Kind of a deal. It's kind of fascinating though, right? Yeah.
Wow.
Thank you for that.
Thanks. Quite sure. Interesting.
Yeah, I think this all here is very, very interesting part of our law. Did anybody else have a question or a comment? We've worn you out and you want to start your Friday night. You're meeting friends for wine and I'm jealous because I still have my rest of my work day. It is nice that you're enjoying. Well, I really enjoyed the chance to spend some time with you. And I think in the slides, I'll just double, I think my email is in there. So if anybody has a question or wants to connect with about our programs and my colleague, Dean Eileen Grena, is just so great to be your colleague, Eileen, and just so
thank
good
you.
With figuring out ways in which we can reach students. I have just always had a curiosity and a passion for connecting with students around the world, studying and learning from you about how does your system work and the like. So, and Marion, it's great to see you again. And Shrew, great to meet you and make your acquaintance.
Thank you, Professor. Yeah, thank you for your wonderful lecture. Yes, I think we've got students and questions, and thank you for answering them. And that was really wonderful, interesting. I guess Mr. Gott, one of the reasons why Mr. Gott didn't go to the board was that he afraid that someone would steal his idea, you know.
But exactly, exactly right. Like, if I ask them, they're going to take it, right? and it's like, he wanted it for me by himself. Absolutely right, yeah. Back to the whole human nature thing, right? Just fascinating, so fascinating.
Yeah. Paul, thank you for everything. So I know I thoroughly enjoyed your lecture and I know that students have really enjoyed it as well. And we would love to hear more from you. And so Marion and I and Shakru have this lovely partnership and you've been part of it for all these years. And so we want to announce that we are actually launching more knowledge about the partnerships next week so that if students want to join you this summer, you can be with them for 4 weeks this summer in your advanced concepts of corporate law class. And so they're more than willing to sign up for more of Professor Paul Regan and his wonderful cases and case law and knowledge. And if they would like to join us for our double degree Masters of Jurisprudence, we have two. We have one in corporate law, and then the other one is in global financial and cyber crimes, which just launched. And so we are elated. I believe Professor Regan's class is also incorporated into both of those degrees. And so we will always have Professor Regan with us, and we hope that we'll have you with us. So please join us on Friday, same time, same channel. Shakru has kindly put on the web meeting in our link. So we hope we see all of you then.
Yes, please do register beforehand so we know how many people have registered and we kind of be ready to answer your questions. Do participate. We'll be happy to see everybody. With that said, that we are thanking everybody for the participation. Thank you. Have a good night. Have a good weekend. Wonderful weekend. So
thank you all. Bye-bye. Great to be with you.
One more
thank
time.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.